Swamiji, whom I only taught, is addressing right now 200 people. I have 25 people. Satyanash ho gaya. That would be against the very wisdom I am talking. To stop comparing, unless it is, you know, very objective functional thing. You are buying some fruits. You compare one with another. This is fresh you take. Don't buy fruits without comparing, closing your eyes. There are 100 other things which are called functional, mechanical, right? Over there you have to compare which is good, which is bad. In buying, in selecting a person for a specific job, you know, you have time to get some plumber. And last time a particular plumber you brought did not do a good job. So you try out and then you know that this plumber is better than that plumber. These are all functional things. But this ego, you know, is rooted in psychological domain. You must know the difference between functional and psychological. What is psychological domain? It is something marked by very many deeper criteria. Take for example the simple example I gave. Somebody has less money. On the basis of having less money, if he thinks I am a lesser human being, my overall self-worth is less. The other guy with more money deserves to be on this earth. I deserve to only decide how to end my life now. On the railway track or jump into a river or... Now, on a little criterion of having less money, many times that money is enough to run the show, but because of this comparison, on a figment of fact, there is blowing things out of proportion and the man goes to the conclusion, I don't think I deserve to live on this earth. I am such a failure. Who says you are a failure? Because I have less money or I am short. Or I am, whatever, you know. Those are little things. If you are short, it may be a problem in playing basketball. But it's not a problem in 100 other things of life. In fact, there was a children's magazine called Ambuli Mama, Chanda Mama, many names, you know. There was a one-page story once. And there was a short man. And some people laughed at him. He said, right away, instantly I say, all of you are laughing at me, I will do something now which none of you can do. With chest up he spoke. They said, what is it you can do, short guy? There was a short door there. He walked, you know, moving his hands and walked through it and then came back again, said, walk the way I walked through this door. If they try to walk like that, they'll hit their head. Short guy could do it. It's all in the mind, therefore we call it psychological. That I am short, that I have less money, or that I have knowledge of only one language while she or he knows five languages, those things have application in a little area. But for one area, if they have relevance, in 99 areas, they have no relevance. If you know five languages, it won't help in 99 other cases. In one particular area where multi-language, multilinguistic skills may be warranted, it will help you. In 99 other places, it won't help you. But psychological domain is such, where on that one little thing that my brother knows five languages and I know only one, the mind, the psychology goes to a sweeping generalization. My brother is an accomplished person and I am a failure in life. That is wrong. Therefore, the ego is a psychological construction based on comparison, based on memories, based on questionable beliefs, based on certain ideas which are to be debated. Now, when Maharshi Ramana says, by restraining your breath, your ego subsides, what is meant is, your ideas of being inferior or superior, these are the hallmarks of ego. they subside, they don't disappear. They are there, but they don't raise their ugly head for a while. Liyate is temporarily subsiding. And I don't have to comment more. The second line of the shloka, number 11 itself, gives an analogy. If somebody catches a bird, puts it in a cage, jala pakshi, cage or jala literally means net. A bird in a net is temporarily in our possession. If we are a little careless and while taking the bird with us, if we a little bit open that net, the bird flies away. Just like that, if you and I do some yoga, some upasana, some breath control, we feel that, I am so peaceful now. And we get the illusion that our job is done. Maharshi Ramana says, not really. The job is not done by merely quietening the mind or calming the mind. The job is done when the root cause of a certain false thinking, of certain false belief, that root cause has to be removed. Therefore, he says, you must first understand that there is, of course, a relation between thinking and breathing. The 12th verse says, chitta, thinking, mind, vayavaha, the plural is because in our shastras, breath is just one form of prana. There are 5 pranas, prana, apana, vyana, udana and samana. Some Vedanta works talk about another 5 upapranas also. Like, you know, there were Pandavas and there were also upapandavas who died, who got burnt when that Lakshagriha was burnt, or when was that? Maybe that time. The upapandavas, younger Pandavas, Pandava juniors, they died. So Pandava seniors survived. So prana and upapranas we have in the shastras. Some Devadatta, Krikala, Dhananjaya, such names are given to them. If you want to read a Vedanta text called Vedanta Sara, you have names of those 5 upapranas and their functions also. But here, vayavaha is plural, bahuvachana. Vayuhu, vayu, vayavaha. Single, dual and plural. That's because pranas are many. Breath is one expression of it. Pranas, the energies in us, suppose are controlled, then automatically they control the mind. Why? Shakayordvai shakti mulaka. Second line of the 12th verse. You have a branch of a tree, and then the branch further splits into 2 sub-branches. Upashaka. When there are upashakas, if you pull A, B also gets pulled. If you pull B, A also comes towards you. Why go to branch of a tree and the sub-branches? Take the example of a table with 4 legs. If you pull one leg of the table, the other 3 also come towards you. You can't say, I wanted only one leg. The 4 legs are connected to the same table. They are not independent. Likewise, the logic here is, if you do regulated breathing, then though your attention was on breathing and not on the thought, not on mind, not on emotions, just do it and see, mind also becomes calm. Just a minute ago, you are burning with anger about somebody, and then you started doing pranayama. That thought of anger subsides. Lust or greed, jealousy or pride, you name it. Just a while ago, suppose they were up and active, thanks to pranayama. And Maharshi himself recommended a deceptively simple practice. He said, you don't have to do complicated pranayamas like counting how many numbers to breathe in, how much of count to breathe out. Or in some pranayamas, as you know, You breathe in through the right nostril, breathe out through the left nostril. In some other pranayamas, brahmari or something, I guess you put your thumb on the ears, close the ears and you have to learn it from a proper teacher. Some other pranayama, you raise the hand while breathing in and bring the hands down while breathing out. At another place, a teacher will tell you in the pranayama, ensure that when you breathe in, your belly comes up, and when you breathe out, the belly goes in. The belly should go up as though you are filling the belly with your in-breath, and belly goes in as though the air is taken out from the belly. So one can synchronize the movement of belly, stomach, up and down with breathing in and breathing out. So there are lots of rules. Maharshi says, you know, none of them is necessary. Breathe normally, anyhow you are breathing, and just observe the breathing. I already said it is deceptively simple. You and I would jump at it, oh, then I won't learn any other pranayama. Thank you. I'll just breathe normally and notice. Try noticing your own breathing is extremely difficult. The mind runs away. Within half a minute, the mind goes away. Whereas if you have some rule, 6 in and 9 out, 6 in, I do that every morning almost. I raise my hand, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and breathe in. Then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, breathe out. So I do that for some 5 minutes, then I do some other Kapalbhati, and I do it quite effectively. And I have tried sometimes, no pranayama, I'll just do prana vikshana. Within a few seconds, there is no vikshana, nothing. You are thinking about, you know, where tomorrow you will go, who will come to meet you tomorrow, all kinds of So prana vikshana, in contrast to pranayama, appears simpler, but it is possible for only those who have already advanced quite a bit. Prana vikshana. But if you can do it, nothing like that. Then you don't need to do pranayama marked by some rules. Either way, prana rodhana, vayu rodhana can mean pranayama or prana vikshana, some form of restraint of breathing. Then the mind also gets restrained. Lastly, if in some way, whatever, you restrain the mind, without your attempting it, your breathing will get restrained. You may be controlling your mind maybe by japa. Suddenly in between, if you were to pay attention to how you are breathing, you will be surprised. Your breathing would have got very regulated. So breath and mind, like two branches shooting out from the same source, are closely interconnected. And he himself says, Shakti Moolakat. In our Shastras, it is said there is a certain primordial Prakriti Shakti, and that Prakriti has some subdivisions. It has got Kriya Shakti and Jnana Shakti. Kriya Shakti is what expresses as Prana, and Jnana Shakti, the power to know, this is big, this is small, this is white, that is black. The power to know, Jnana Shakti, inherent in Prakriti, appears as Manaha. Manaha is an expression of Jnana Shakti of Prakriti. Prana is an expression of Kriya Shakti of Prakriti. Therefore, Prakriti is that main branch from which Prana and Manaha are the sub-branches. Therefore, no wonder to control A brings about control of B, and controlling B leads to controlling of A. All right. In this context, please tell us, why do you use the word liyate? You did not say nasyati. If we control our breathing, our ego is destroyed, you didn't say. You said the ego subsides, only to raise its head again when the opportunity arises. Why? He says in 13, Laya vinashane ubhaya rodhane.
Laya vinashane ubhaya rodhane.
Laya gatam punar bhavati no mritam. लय विनाशने उभय रोधने लय गतं पुनर्भवति नोमृतम्। प्राणबन्धनाल्लीनमानसम् एकचिन्तनान्नाशमेत्यदः प्राणबन्धनात् लीनमानसम् एकचिन्तनात् नाशमेत्यदः The handout given to you, which I had only prepared, there is a slight error. In 13, second line, Layagatam Punar Bhavati Nomrutam, in Devanagari, there is what